now they're in a random order, and she sends these all of these ciphertexts to Bob. In this case, there's 16 ciphertexts. She sends them all to Bob in this random order. There is a step that I will skip for now. Remember, Alice has input X and Bob has input Y. And for each input X, there is a corresponding key, AX. And for each Y, there's a corresponding key, BY. Let's imagine that somehow Bob obtains these correct keys. So he has one of the A keys and one of the B keys. He has 16 ciphertexts. So what can he do? He can try to decrypt all of them. And when he does that, only one of these ciphertexts should open, right? Maybe X is 4 and B is 2. So if Bob has A4 and B2, he can try to decrypt all of these ciphertexts. Only one of them should work. And when he looks inside that ciphertext, he sees the value F of 4, 2. That's the output that they wanted to learn, right? Alice has 4, Bob has 2. They should learn F of 4, 2. Okay, I want to argue that this protocol is secure. In this previous slide, I was showing you everything from Alice's perspective. And I think the important part about these MPC protocols is that Alice and Bob can have very different perspectives. So this was Alice's perspective. She knows all of the A's, she knows all of the B's, she knows all of these encryptions. This slide is closer to Bob's perspective. He sees a bunch of ciphertexts, but he doesn't know what's inside of them. He can only open this one ciphertext. So if we want to be more formal, we want to say that let's write down everything that Bob sees in this protocol. He sees all 16 ciphertexts. This is how they are generated. He also sees A4 and B2 in this case. I didn't tell you how he learns those, but we will talk about that later. But this is everything that he sees. And I want to say that this view, Bob's view, can be simulated only given the output of the in the ideal world. So in the ideal world, the output is F4, 2, and we should be able to simulate that. Simulate this view only given that information. So I claim that the simulated view, so Bob's real view, looks indistinguishable from a view where he just gets some random A key and some random B key and one ciphertext that decrypts to the ideal world output, and then a bunch of garbage ciphertexts, so like dummy ciphertexts, encryptions of a dummy value. And these two views are indistinguishable if you have a good enough encryption scheme. So I need an encryption scheme where an encryption of C under the keys A and B is indistinguishable from an encryption of something else, as long as one of these two keys is unknown to the distinguisher. So if you look at this first ciphertext, let's choose a more interesting one, actually. Let's look at this ciphertext. This ciphertext should be indistinguishable from a garbage junk ciphertext because Bob doesn't know the key A2. He knows the key B2, but there's one key that he doesn't know, so we need an encryption scheme where an encryption scheme that uses two keys, and if you don't know one of the keys, then that ciphertext looks indistinguishable from a dummy ciphertext. Right? In most of these cases, Bob doesn't know either of the keys. But the point is that the simulated view can be generated using only this piece of information, this f of xy. So that means that the real view must not leak any more information than f of xy. Right? So you remember that's how we define security. sent in the protocol, they don't leak any more information than f of xy. So that's the privacy property. Okay, so there is a problem with this protocol. You probably realize that when I described the protocol, I said, first you write down the truth table of this function. So the truth table of any interesting function is huge, exponentially large. So this protocol requires Alice to send an exponential number of ciphertexts to Bob. That's very bad. The other problem is that I didn't explain how does Bob learn the correct encryption keys, the keys that encode the real inputs. Okay, so I want to talk about how we fix these problems. So we fix the first problem with the very, this is my favorite idea in cryptography. I described this protocol where you use keys to encrypt the final output of the function, right? That was the plain text inside of these encryptions. A better idea is you encrypt the keys to other truth tables. So here, using these keys for A and B, we encrypt intermediate values, which are keys, and then we use those keys to encrypt another table, and we can chain these things together. And that's what allows this to work. So I'm going to talk about this first idea, and then later I'll talk about how Bob learns these correct keys. It uses something called oblivious transfer. So we'll talk about that in just a second. Okay, so here's the real protocol for Yao's garbled circuits. Okay, so Alice and Bob agree that they want to compute this function of their inputs. So they write the function as a Boolean circuit. So here's a Boolean circuit with some gates and some wires. Every gate in the circuit has a truth table. So this function is an AND gate, but it has this this is an AND gate. This is a bubble that means a negation, a little NOT gate. This is an XOR gate. So each of these gates has a truth table, and Alice and Bob want to evaluate this circuit on their inputs. So each of these input wires is a bit that belongs to either Alice or Bob, and they want to learn this output value. Okay, so every gate has a truth table. So I'm going to describe what Alice does. It's very important that Alice and Bob have different view of information. So right now I'll describe Alice's view. This is what it means to garble a circuit. So Alice will garble the circuit by doing the following. For every wire, she picks two values. I'll call them labels. You can call them keys or labels. I usually call them labels. These are used as encryption keys, but I call them labels. So on each wire, choose a different, two different labels, one with the subscript 0 and one with the subscript 1. And these labels will represent true and false on each wire. So I could rewrite the truth tables in terms of these labels. So A0 means false, B0 means false, and in this gate, false on both wires gives you a false output. And on the output wire here is the output wire with E0 as its false label. Okay, so this is what Alice is doing. She generates a label for each wire, and she can encrypt the truth table of each gate in the same way that I described before. Okay, so she uses A0 and B0 as keys to encrypt the value E0. four times the number of gates in the circuit. Now let's think about Bob's perspective. If Bob knows only one value on each wire, you can think of that as an encoding of a bit on that wire. I'll say this is a garbled encoding. So if you just know the value A1, that's like an encoding of true on this particular wire. So that's a garbled encoding. So if you have this garbled circuit, all of these ciphertexts, and you have a garbled encoding of on the input wires, the circuit just has four input wires, and here is a garbled encoding of input 1001. If you have that information, then you can start to evaluate the garbled circuit. So let's look at this first gate. If I have A1 and B0, then, and I have these four ciphertexts, well, then I can only decrypt this third ciphertext, and then I will learn E0. And I could do the same thing for this gate. So in this gate, only one of the ciphertexts can be opened. I will learn F1. And here I will learn G1. And now I have F and G. I can use them to decrypt this garbled truth table. I learn H0, I0. Okay, the important idea is that in the protocol, Bob sees a garbled circuit, all of these ciphertexts, and he sees the garbled input, this garbled input encoding. And the idea is that the only thing that's really possible is to evaluate the circuit in the way that I described. Because you can think of this invariant that holds. So the invariant is that Bob should only know one of the two possible labels on each wire. So at each gate, if you only know one of the two possible values on the input wires of the gate, then you can only open one ciphertext, and then you will only learn one of the labels on the output wire. On the other hand, if I told you both I0 and I1, then you would be able to recognize that I0 is. Let me back up. If you only see one of these labels, remember, both of these labels, like think of E0 and E1, they're both generated uniformly at random. So Alice knows that E0 means false and E1 means true. But if I just show you E1, it just looks like a random thing. You don't know that it's the true or the false label. So when Bob is evaluating this circuit, he doesn't know whether he's holding the true label or the false label for any wire. However, hi, is there a question?
Yeah, I think there's a question. You can see that?
I don't see a question in the chat.
Let me repeat.
Okay.
So how can you know that I only use A1, B0 of the second one instead of the first ciphertext for the first stage, for the first gate?
I didn't quite hear the question.
Okay, I'll repeat. Sorry.
Now I can see. Yeah. How can I know that I only use A1, B0 of the third one instead of the first? Okay, so you're asking, how do I know that? How does Bob know to decrypt the third ciphertext in this gate? I think that's what that's an important question. There is one step that I skipped. So if we go all the way back to this this warm-up construction. So in this warm-up protocol, there's an important step where we randomly permute these ciphertexts. If we didn't randomly permute them, then when Bob goes through and he tries to decrypt all of them, he finds the one that he can decrypt. But if we didn't randomize the order of these ciphertexts, he would know just by the position, he would know that the input was 4-2, right? If the table really looked like this, and he decrypted this one, he would say, well, that's the 14th item in the table is always for input 4-2. So that's why we randomize the order here. And I didn't really emphasize it when I was on this slide, but in this simulated view, you just pick a random position for this ciphertext. So that's something that's important, but I didn't draw it in this picture. So the garbled circuit should be all of these ciphertexts, but each group of four ciphertexts should be randomly shuffled. So I'm not shuffling them in my picture. And then Bob should try to decrypt all of them, and only one of those decryptions will succeed. So I hope that answers the question. Actually, next week I'll say more about garbled circuits, and it's very inefficient to try to decrypt all four of these ciphertexts and then just check which one is successful. There's a way that you can tell Bob which ciphertext to decrypt without leaking information about whether this is a 1 or a 0. But for this example, I want you to imagine that for every gate, there are four ciphertexts. They are shuffled into a random order, and then Bob will try to decrypt. You know, Bob knows that he has this key and he has this key. He'll try to decrypt all four of these with those keys, and only one of those decryptions will succeed. So I hope that answers the question. But yeah, that is important. Great. Okay, so the idea is that, if you just see a garbled circuit and a garbled input, the garbled input is just, in this case, four different random strings. It doesn't tell you anything about the zeros and ones. When you evaluate these garbled gates, you learn more labels for more wires, but each label just looks like a random thing. It doesn't tell you whether it's a zero label or a one label. But usually we want Alice and Bob to learn the output of the circuit. So if Alice also tells Bob, if Alice announces I0 and I1 and sends those to Bob, and now Bob, when he decrypts, he sees I0, then he can say, oh, the circuit output 0. So the output of the function is 0. Okay, there's a question in the chat. How does Bob verify whether the decryption is correct? I'm not being very specific about that. You can imagine that this is like authenticated encryption or something. So I haven't given any details about this encryption scheme, and that's because I'm gonna give you all the details next week. So for today, you can imagine that this encryption scheme is authenticated encryption. So if you try to decrypt something in an authenticated encryption scheme and you use the wrong keys, you'll get some error message. So that's what I imagine in this picture. I don't want an encryption scheme where if you encrypt with the wrong key, you just get a garbage value, because actually probably what you're asking. I think it's maybe the easiest thing is to imagine that this is some authenticated encryption scheme. And decryption gives some error when you decrypt with the wrong keys. I'm not giving many details about that because once we talk about the details of these garbled circuits next week, we don't have to worry about decrypting things with the wrong keys. It just doesn't, it's not relevant in the real garbled circuits. But it is relevant for this simplified example. That's good. Everyone is trying to break this protocol, which is good. I think every time you see a crypto talk, you should be trying to break the protocol that the person is presenting. Okay. So that's the main idea of Yao's garbled circuits protocol, although I didn't show one step of it yet. But just this idea of taking a circuit and garbling the circuit and garbling the input is called a garbling scheme. So there's this paper from 2012 that gave formal definitions for this garbling scheme. So the first part that I showed you, which is what Alice does, is the garble algorithm. She takes a circuit, and then for every wire, she chooses two labels, and then she encrypts four ciphertexts for each gate, and that's the garbled circuit. She also generates this encoding information. So encoding information is just the two labels on each of the input wires. So if you have the labels on the input wires and you have an input to the circuit, then you can choose the correct ones and get a garbled input. So garbled input is just a single label on each input wire. And then in the protocol, Bob sees a garbled circuit and he sees a garbled input and he can evaluate and get a garbled output. So in the previous example, garbled output is just like I0 would be a garbled output. And if you have the garbled output and you have both labels for all of the output wires, then you can figure out the value on that output wire, which is the output of the circuit, right? So if you know that the garbled output is I0 and you know both I0 and I1, then you can say, you can decode the output and say the output is 0 in this case. So this is kind of the more formal notation. You'll see if you read papers about garbled circuits protocols, they probably use this notation. And this notation helps us talk about different security guarantees. So the basic one is that if you see the garbled circuit, the garbled input, and the decoding information, then that reveals nothing beyond the circuit output. So just going back to this picture, if Alice sends to Bob all of these ciphertexts, that's the garbled circuit, and she sends, somehow Bob learns a garbled input, that's these four labels, and Alice also sends both I0 and I1, then Bob will definitely learn that the circuit output was 0, but he learns nothing more than that. Right? So that information, this information can be simulated just given f of x. And I just also want to mention that nothing in this talk it doesn't say anything about hiding the circuit f. We're not trying to hide this Boolean circuit. The only thing we're trying to hide is the inputs to the circuit and also the values on the wires. But the circuit itself is public. So that's why this definition says this information reveals, it can reveal F and it can reveal field f of x, but nothing more. That's privacy. There are these other definitions. Obliviousness is kind of similar. An important one is authenticity. So if we, I'm sorry to go back and forth so much. If Alice sends the garbled circuit to Bob and she sends a garbled input, then we know that Bob will learn I0 in this case. But if we don't tell Bob what I1 is, he should never be able to guess it, right? He shouldn't be able to lie and say that, oh, looks like I got the circuit to output a 1 instead of a 0. Right, so that just means, you know, given the garbled circuit and a garbled output, or a garbled input, it's hard to find any valid output wire labels except for, you know, the correct, the wire label that encodes the correct outputs. So that's called authenticity. Sometimes that can be a useful property as well. There are other properties that we won't get into. You should just know that these exist, but we won't talk about these. Sometimes you want to hide what types of gates there are in the circuit. Sometimes you want to allow an adversary to choose inputs to the circuit after seeing the garbled circuit. So these definitions say that you have to first choose the input X, and then you get to see the garbled circuit. But in some situations, you have to give the garbled circuit first, and then the adversary can choose X. So you need a stronger security definition. Okay, there's a question. For each function we should design and transfer the garbled circuit, can we reuse a separate garbled circuit for any function? The question about reusing a garbled circuit is very important. So I don't know if this is what you're asking, but I can see that in this circuit, there's two gates that are the same kind of gate, right? Both of these have the same truth table, but I still generate a different garbled table for each one. And that's very important because imagine that we reuse this garbled circuit again on a different input. So on a different input, maybe we will have to reveal A0. So now Bob knows A0 and A1, and now he can open this ciphertext that he couldn't open before, and he sees that it contains E0. It contains the same thing as this ciphertext. So he knows that's false, right? Because in this truth table, the only thing that shows up two times is a 0. So, I think it's important to say this, that these garbled circuits could just be used one time, right? If you use them more than one time on different inputs, then they will leak some of the bits. They will leak some of these input bits. If that's not clear, then I can maybe draw something on a different slide. But I think the question was about reusing garbled circuits, and the problem is that they can never be reused. Maybe we can go back to that a little bit later if there are still questions. Okay, there's one last step that I haven't told you about. I haven't told you how Bob gets the garbled input. So here is a circuit. It has four input wires, and some of the input wires are bits that belong to Alice, and some are bits that belong to Bob. So if Alice is garbling the circuit, when she garbles the circuit, she chooses A0 and A1, she chooses B0 and B1, and she knows her input. Maybe she knows her input is 1, 0, so she can just send, she this is really easy. On the other hand, it's harder to get Bob's garbled input. So Alice knows both C0 and C1, but Bob knows his input. So he wants to learn one of these, but he can't just tell Alice which one he wants to learn. We need something that works like this. Alice inputs two wire labels. Bob inputs a choice bit, and he learns one of the two wire labels that he chose. And Alice should not learn which one he chose. So this is called oblivious transfer, OT for short. So if we have oblivious transfer, then we will be done with the whole protocol. I think I have a summary later. But if we have oblivious transfer, then we can let Bob learn the garbled input. Okay, so how does this work? So again, there's a wire in the circuit. Alice knows both of the labels, but this is an input wire for Bob's input, so he knows which label he needs to learn. So one way to do this uses public key cryptography. So Bob is going to generate two public keys, and he'll have a trap door to one of these public keys. So he has a public key to PKC, but he generates the other public key in some way so that he doesn't know the secret key. So you need a public key encryption scheme with what I call a blind key generation. So there should be a way to sample something that looks like a public key, but you sample it without knowing what the secret key is. Okay, so Alice just sees two public keys. Bob knows the key to one of them, but Alice can't tell which is which. And so she just encrypts. This is now a public key encryption in this slide. So she encrypts the wire labels under these public keys. And now Bob knows the secret key to decrypt only one of these ciphertexts, so he can learn the wire label that he wants. So this is one way to do it. Everything that I'm showing you today is not optimized. The rest of these lectures are going to talk about how all of these steps can be optimized. For this first lecture, I'm just trying to show you something that works, something that you can understand, but it's not the most efficient way to do this. Okay. So here is the big overview of the protocol. They both agree on a circuit, F. Alice garbles the circuit, so for every wire in the circuit, she chooses two labels. For every gate in the circuit, she generates four ciphertexts. She shuffles them randomly. She sends all of the ciphertexts to Bob. Some of the input wires in the circuit are Alice's inputs. So she can just send the garbled input for those wires. But Bob still needs the wire labels for the other input wires corresponding to his input. So to do that, they use oblivious transfer. So if there are n input wires for Bob, then they do n copies of oblivious transfer. So then Bob will learn a garbled encoding of his input. So now he has garbled encoding of X and Y, and he should be able to evaluate the circuit and get, you know, the wire labels on the output wires. But Alice has also sent, you know, all of the wire labels for the output wires, so he can look at what he learned and say and figure out which one is true and which one is false, only for the output wires. So he can compute the output of the circuit. shares that with Alice when he's done. And I think we argued that when Alice only sees the garbled circuit, the garbled inputs, and the output wire labels, he doesn't learn anything more than the circuit output, the ideal world output. That's what Bob learns. It's easy to see that Alice doesn't learn anything. The only thing she learns is this protocol message. It's just the circuit output. So it's easy to simulate Alice's view. She learns nothing from these oblivious transfers. Okay, so we're getting to the end of my slides. So I talked about secure computation. There are several parties, they have private inputs. They want to evaluate some function of their inputs. They want to learn the output of that function, but nothing else. And we talked about a few examples. I talked about how to define security. Security uses this real world, ideal world definition. So the protocol is secure if every attack against the protocol can be simulated in the ideal world. And then we talked about Yao's protocol, where you have like a truth table for every gate of a circuit, and you sort of encrypt the truth table in a special way. And then you also need these oblivious transfer steps to get the right values on the input wires. And once you have that, then Bob can evaluate the circuit blindly. Over the next few lectures, I'm going to tell you how to make all of this faster and more efficient. So the garbled circuits that I showed you today are very inefficient, and I will show you all of the tricks that I know about that can make garbled circuits smaller. So that's a special topic for me, because I have several papers about garbled circuits and how to make them smaller. So it's one of my favorite topics. So I'll show you all the tricks that you can use to make garbled circuits smaller. Because actually, if we look at this protocol, this garbled circuit is most of the communication is this huge garbled circuit. So if we can make it smaller, then the entire protocol gets much more efficient. I will also, so that's next week. And then after that, I'll talk about this oblivious transfer step. Oblivious transfer is useful in lots of different secure computation protocols, not only Yao's protocol, but many other places. And it's very expensive, because the way I described it, it uses public key cryptography. Everything else in the garbled circuits is using symmetric key crypto, but the oblivious transfers use public key crypto, so that makes it very expensive. So I'll show you a trick to make oblivious transfer actually very cheap. And then the last lecture that I will give is, if we know that we're evaluating a specific function, then we can design a whole protocol just for that function. So Yao's protocol will work with any function, because you can evaluate any Boolean circuit. But if you know that your favorite function has a really expensive Boolean circuit, then you can design a special purpose protocol just for that function. And so I'll talk about protocols for set intersection, which are some of my favorite applications of secure MPC. I think that's it looks like that's my last slide. So I know we have some time left over, and I want to make sure everyone has a chance to ask the questions, especially if anything was confusing. Good, and looks like there's already a suggestion. So I'll talk about what happens that's what he learns. Okay, yeah, I think we are comfortable with that. So what if we use the same ciphertext and now we try to evaluate it again on a different input. So now the input is 1010. So this is still the same. This is the same. Okay, now I have C1 and D0. That. Maybe this doesn't work very well. I haven't thought about this yet. So we can learn G0. Oh, but I can also decrypt all of these, right? At this point I know C0, C1, D0, D1. So I can decrypt all four of these ciphertexts. Now I know G0, G1, and F1. So basically I can decrypt those two. And I'll still just learn H0. That's the same. Yeah, so in this case, so these are all the ones that can be decrypted. But now there's a problem here, because if we look at Bob can decrypt all four of these. So Bob decrypts all four of these, so he knows that he can see that these three are the same. He knows that the truth table must have been 0100. Even if these four ciphertexts were shuffled, he sees that these three were the same and this one is different. And so he knows that he can know that G0 must be false. G1 must be true. So he learns the meaning of this bit in both executions. And he could also conclude that, so this was C0 D1, he must also know that, he can conclude from the truth table here. Yeah, I think the truth table is in this case, is 0, 1. There's only one combination that gives true on this gate, so he can figure out that C0 must be false. D1 must be true. So there are some things that he can deduce. So he learned, so because we reuse these same ciphertexts but revealed more of the input labels, we leak the value on these wires for this example. For a different example, you'll leak different information. But here on three different wires, Bob learned the value on that wire. He's only supposed to learn the value on the output wire. Somehow I closed my chat. Oh, there's a Q&A window. Okay, that's why I didn't see the question the first time. Sorry about that. I only had the chat window open. Now I don't have it open. So I need to open it again.
There's another question, whether the encoding of Bob's input is necessary or not.
Right. Okay, so I can see that now. Because the evaluation is on Bob's side. Yeah, so the important invariant here is that Alice should know both wire labels, and Bob should know just one of them. And that's the important invariant that should be true for all of the wires. So there. Yeah, I mean, I think I understand the question. It's a reasonable question. Let's use this. but Bob needs, he needs more than just his input, because C0 and C1 are like encryption keys. He can't guess them. Alice chose two encryption keys. Bob will never guess one of these encryption keys, right? And we can't, yeah, if I were to change, let me make a new picture here. So I think your question is saying, like, you know, don't have these wire labels. This is Bob's input to the circuit is here. Let's not use these wire labels. Let's actually just encrypt using just the bit 0 as the key. And let's encrypt using, you know, the bit 1 as the key. I mean, maybe that's what you're thinking, but I hope it's obvious that you can't encrypt something with a single bit, right? So there needs to be, something needs to be encrypted with a key, and Alice needs to be the person who chose the key. So there has to be some encoding. You can't just encrypt something under a bit 0 and a bit 1. Bob can just imagine that he has a 0 one day, and then imagine that he has a 1 in the next second, and he could open up all of these ciphertexts, and then the same bad thing would happen. So you want to restrict Bob to open just a single ciphertext. That means things have to be encrypted with real keys that Alice chose, so there needs to be some encoding process. Okay, but does not Bob always know C00 and C1 is 1? Good point. So the question is, maybe for this example, if this is Bob's, these are Bob's input wires, he does know that, yeah, in this case, he knows that this is a 0 and he knows that this is a 1, because those are his inputs. And so he'll also know that, whatever gate this is, he knows that this is a 1. But from Bob's perspective, like, these are Alice's inputs, so he doesn't know what's on this wire, and he won't know what's on this wire. That's a true observation, and you know, in this circuit could probably be simplified. So I present a very general version of Yao's garbled circuits. It treats Alice inputs, Bob inputs, all the same way. I think you are correct that in this example, if Bob knows both of these input wires, maybe just make this thing an input wire, right? Bob computes this part in his head because he has all the inputs to this part of the circuit, and maybe we should make this an input wire. But yeah, it's true that but the first time that there's a gate with one of Alice's inputs coming into it, the output of that gate will be unknown to Bob. Yeah, that's a very good question.
Preserving federated learning, especially secure aggregation. Do you think it would have good effect? That's from the machine learning community.
Right. So you can use the garbled circuits protocol for any function, but the cost of garbled circuits depends on the size of the Boolean circuit. So let's take the problem that you want to solve. Imagine writing that as a Boolean circuit. If that Boolean circuit is huge, then garbled circuits is maybe not the best choice. There are many, many other secure computation protocols, and they have different trade-offs. efficiently in hardware, then garbled circuits will be pretty efficient, because hardware is similar. It's a similar architecture, right? Writing something as a Boolean circuit. So, in principle, you can use garbled circuits for anything, including federated learning. In practice, maybe federated learning is more about arithmetic operations, like multiplications, divisions, additions, and those operations may be more efficient as an arithmetic circuit, and there are better protocols to support arithmetic circuits. The problem is there's just too many secure computation protocols. It's very hard even for the experts to know which is the best one for any particular application. But yeah, I do want to stress that garbled circuits protocol is general purpose. It will work for any Boolean circuit, but some problems have huge Boolean circuits, so it could be inefficient.
Next question, is there any use for tool for or algorithm that to convert a function into a circuit, Boolean circuit, I guess?
Yeah, there are several papers that use that they have tools for generating garbled circuits, tools for generating circuits that you can use for this garbled circuits protocol. You can use hardware design languages like VHDL. Hardware design languages, and they can generate circuits. In garbled circuits, you'll see that it turns out that these kind of gates are free. Not that one. These kind of gates are free, and these kind of gates are expensive. And so you can tell the hardware design tool that you can tell it that these are free, and so try to minimize the number of these gates. There are people that build tools to do that. There are some, if this person is really interested in the question, they can send me an email and I can list some specific papers. I don't remember the names right now, but there are some papers of tools that can generate these circuits. There are also some high level languages, like you write a program in C and then the compiler generates garbled gates on the fly. So there are tools that do this as well. You don't need to have the entire circuit all in one place to do this. You can generate the circuit as the program is running. So that's also possible.
So if you are interested, please send an email to Mike. He will reply you with more details.
Yes, and if you can spell my last name, then you can find me on the internet. Yu has my email address too. There's a question about passive into active secure. Only the receiver learns the outputs. Transform active secure only to be secure. Okay, so this is a question about semi-honest versus malicious. And it's a question about if only one person learns the output, then do we need to worry about both parties being malicious? I think the answer is you need to worry about both parties being malicious. It doesn't matter who is getting the output. So even if I don't get output, I can still behave maliciously and mess up the computation. And you still need to worry about that in the security proof. So, unfortunately, you don't get any benefit to just having one party learn the output. You don't just get to ignore malicious security problems in that case. If the receiver is adversary, yeah, if the re- maybe they force the wrong output. So you need to worry about those things. So.
Okay. So the timing is perfect.
Incredible. Yeah, I'm very grateful for those questions so that we could we could fit the time perfectly.
Thank you for the very educational lecture on the simulation paradigm and the garbled circuit and oblivious transfer. And we look forward to the concrete instantiation and the optimization of the garbled circuits next in the next talk. Probably
yes.
one week from now, or we can negotiate.
Okay.
Actually, today, Andy Yao is around, so I believe he will be very happy to see a post about his protocol.
Yeah. Well, if you have Andy Yao walking around, I don't know why you would invite me, but. Yeah, that's fantastic. Yeah, so we can schedule the next session.
Sure.
But yeah, I look forward to seeing you all again next time, maybe next week, maybe in a few weeks.